Good evening, friends. We'll start the CME just in a minute. I am taking Dr. Rajnish Kapoor's wire time. It's very important to introduce him to the gathering. Actually, this CME was supposed to be last year, somewhere in October. And we had planned everything in Taj Palace. Sir had invited one of his friends from US, and sir was to be with him to do this CME for us. But at the last moment, sir had some very urgent family issue, and we could not do this CME. Sir, aaj us CME ka rent hamare upar se utar rahe. Big hand for sir. Dr. Rajnish Kapoor. I will just introduce him to you in a minute. So big hand for Dr. J.P.S. Suthi, our chronic persistent chairperson. I thank Medtronic India to do this CME for us, Dr. Rajnish Kapoor, Director of Interventional Cardiology. Just two words about the forum. You see this here, Physician Forum of India. It's a registered body. It was registered last 30th of August. We have been doing CMEs for the last 10 years, more than 500 CMEs. A CME every Wednesday, without a break, unless it is a Holi or a Diwali. And believe me, we are not very big people. We are very, very small people. I don't have to go and ask the sponsor now to do the CME for us. Sponsor comes to me and asks for a date. And we have whole of August and whole of September calendar full. We don't have a date. It's not because I am doing anything exceptional. It's because you people are exceptional. You turn up every Wednesday on one phone call. I would request Dr. J.P.S. Tulsi to introduce Dr. Rajnish Kapoor for us, and then I would leave it to sir to take the CME forward on a very important topic which will be introduced by Dr. J.P.S. Tulsi.
Thank you, Dr. Chauhan. But before I introduce our forum to Dr. Rajnish Kapoor, I'd like to introduce our forum to Dr. Rajnish Kapoor. Sir, this is our group of top elite 70 doctors in South Delhi, the best of the lot. You can see all the stars here, sir. And we have been having this CME for the past 10 years now. And every Wednesday, well, now, a friend, sir, just a word about Dr. Rajnish Kapoor. He's the Senior Director and Interventional Cardiologist at Medanta Hospital. Has transmitted 30 live cases, transmissions in various courses across the globe, internationally. Faculty at various national and international conferences and published 150 papers, national and international. His special interest in valvular aortic intervention besides coronary interventions, and he's going to talk about structural heart disease today. Dr. Rajnish Kapoor, welcome, sir.
Firstly, as Dr. Chauhan just mentioned, you know, we had planned this many months back, but I'll give you the reason, you know, which actually happened. And at that point, we were planning a CME on cardiac transplantation, and I had a very good friend in Mayo Clinic, Dr. Sudhir. So he was visiting India, so I requested him that let's have a CME and we'll call upon the doctors who are really interested in academics. So that point we planned it, but somehow, although it was planned about a month back, somehow my father's TKR surgery was posted on the same day. And that too in the evening, and around that time only he was kind of being extubated or planned for being extubation. So my mindset was not that I leave my father while he had a TKR surgery in Medanta and do the CME. So I requested Dr. Chauhan that day that can we skip it. Although it was very awkward situation for him and for the whole group, but I think they were really cooperative. So I thank the whole group, Dr. Chauhan, for taking care of that day. But that was wonderful. The feeling which I had on that day, literally I actually realized, I perceived that this is the group who is really interested in academics. We do CMEs, on very frequent basis, day in and day out, almost 3 CMEs a month, not in Delhi but all across the India, Northern India, and even up to the Madhya Pradesh or UP or Bihar or these things. We come across many forums, and I tell you from my heart that this forum is one of the best forums who is academically inclined. So I'm not kind of, it's not a flattery or anything, but I just wish, it's my inner feeling that this is one of the best forums. So it's, to have a CME or a academic session with this kind of forum, it's a good feeling in oneself.
Sir, every Wednesday for the past 10 years.
That is the reason. Now, your USP is, I have mentioned. So your USP is that you are more inclined academically, it's a more serious stuff. You are inclined.
Nothing to do with this.
Absolutely. So keep it up. So, carrying the momentum further, as we all know, cardiology is now available almost everywhere, almost in every corner of Delhi, and coronary interventions are being done almost everywhere. It's our stuff also. I practically do almost 80 to 90 angioplasties a month. It's such a busy affair at Vedanta. But if you ask me, obviously once you do so much of volumes, the thrill lies somewhere else. It's kind of a routine job. Even if the left main stentings or the left main bifurcation stentings or the rota ablators or the IVAs or OCDs, so this is kind of a very routine affair. The thrill actually lies in a different kind of interventions or atypical or unique interventions where the more excitement is there, of course, the more planning is there, and also we know that the outcome of patient, because those things are not being done frequently at wider places, those things are rarely done by certain expert operators. So those things are of more value to us. Not that coronary is not of value, coronary is absolutely of value to us, but in the discussion part also, because you people also might be coming across so many coronary intervention, discussion of coronary intervention, it is kind of a bit of monotony. To break that monotony, I thought let's talk of certain things, the unusual interventions which are path breaking, which are very unique in itself and may generate a lot of discussion. And these are the interventions, I'll show you 3 or 4 real life cases which we can discuss and make it interactive. Any questions, you can just raise your hands and we can make it interactive. So in this momentum, I'll show you 3 or 4 cases. This is the case number 1, which I believe was the rarest of the rare. It's not actually a structural heart, but yes, this was the rarest of the rare case, where left bronchus intervention was done by me and we could save this child. Now, to give you the historical background, this girl was 6 years old and had a complex congenital heart disease. Actually, it was pulmonary atresia (PAST), but there was no initial part of pulmonary artery that was atretic and a ventricle septal defect. So, with this congenital heart background, she underwent a two surgical procedures. Now, after 3 weeks of the second surgery done, she was readmitted with a marked respiratory distress in our emergency. On examination, it was found that there was no air entry into the left lung. So left lung was totally collapsed, and the chest X-ray showed a collapse of total left lung. I'll show you the picture. CT chest also showed the same thing, and the reason for this also. These are the pictures. This is the chest x-ray of this 6-year-old girl. No air entry into the left lung, totally white, and the right lung was okay. And this is the CT picture, which, see this point. This was the reason for the collapse of the left lung. There was severe critical pinching of the left bronchus, which was not letting the air entry into the left lung. So obviously the distress was so huge that patient had to be ventilated and was unable to take off from the ventilator even in spite of 7 days of ventilation. So she was not coming out, she was not being weaned off. At that point, there were a lot of discussion. The pediatric cardiac surgeon had lots of discussions with me that how can we salvage this child. So then at that point we started scanning a lot of literature and found out that in literature, in such circumstances where there is something happening in the bronchus externally or internally, there were case reports of balloon dilatations being done and saving the patient. So that's where we planned that otherwise we are almost on verge of losing this child. She was almost going into septicemia after 8 days of ventilator and ventilator not being weaned off since the left lung was not working at all. So we planned that if we really are keen to save this child, let's plan the multiple dilatations of this bronchus in the cath lab. This was the procedure initially. Now the child is ventilated and we are actually intervening through an endotracheal tube. Now just imagine the circumstance. Once we are planning to intervene through endotracheal tube, we have to detach the ventilator and even with no echo bag can be attached. So it can't be done for a long time, you know. We have to be very quick and swift because we are intervening into the trachea and the bronchus through the endotracheal tube. We passed on a wire into the left bronchus. As I mentioned, we planned for a multiple balloon dilatations. So this is the first balloon dilatation being done in the left bronchus. We went on and on, did multiple balloon dilatations. After every balloon dilatation, we tend to check up by giving a small contrast into the left bronchus and see whether something is moving. Something is going distally, which means that we are trying to check whether that pinching effect of the left bronchus was giving way or the passage is being created or not. But nothing was happening. So what was happening? We were doing a balloon dilatation again. The retraction of that pinching was coming back and bronchus was not giving way. That narrowing was not giving way. So we left the procedure there on that day because nothing was happening. And then further, I devoted 3 to 4 hours scanning the literature further. There were few case reports of putting a stent in the bronchus also, although there were many pros and cons. So since, with the family discussion and with the pediatric cardiac surgeon discussion, it was a peripheral stent, almost 9 into 30, the diameter is 9 millimeter. We placed just at the bifurcation and this being deployed. So we deployed the stent. Okay. It's getting stuck somewhere. This is the x-ray the next day. See the change. So whole left lung was expanded, good air entry, and the distress was gone, and actually the girl was extubated in next 2 days. And did well, the antibiotics were on, she responded, infection was controlled and was discharged about
the fifth day post this procedure. So as I mentioned, it was a very rare procedure. Very rare case reports occur in the literature with some kind of intervention in the bronchus. The issues, as I mentioned, there are many pros and cons of this procedure. Now one negative aspect is, once we place a stent, the child has to grow further. The stent size may lag. The stent may hinder with the natural defense mechanisms to throw out secretions, you know. So, to circumvent this problem, there is availability of a retrievable stents also. However, we were unfortunate that we didn't have any retrievable stent in our armamentarium on that day or during the vicinity. But now there are retrievable stents available, that if such interventions have to be done, a retrievable stent should be placed, and after 2 months, once the condition is solved, you take out the retrievable stent. But if it is a permanent stent, then these issues can happen. But in that time zone, we had no other solution to this problem. So we went ahead and that resulted in a positive solution. So this case was widely reported in the print media, that, you know, obviously figuring our name at Vedanta, the docs use a stent meant for heart in 6 years, lung to save. This was the Times of India, Hindustan Times, I suppose. So this was a very interesting case.
So can it become a nidus for the infections?
Yes, it's not a nidus for the infection per se, but you know, there are ciliary movements happening in the bronchus and the trachea, throwing out the secretions if at all this happens. So in that part, that defense mechanism gets altered. That is the negative aspect. The second case, obviously, as we talk of structural heart interventions, is TAVR. I think TAVR is the talk of the town. So this is a percutaneous aortic valve replacement. At Medanta, we have been doing it extensively, not very extensively, but we have done around 45 cases or so. I have personally done it few cases, so pretty lucky and privileged to have done TAVR cases, which only few operators all over India have done. So this case I'll show you, which I have done around a month back, TAVR in a very high risk patient. So normal aortic stenosis, we all know, the indication is surgical aortic valve replacement. But in patients who are really comorbid and are very high risk, where surgical AVR is associated with lot of morbidity and mortality, the TAVR is the real need. We can save a patient with percutaneous aortic valve replacement without any surgery, without any blood loss, without any general anesthesia. So this comes very handy, although the negative aspect is cost. So this is a costly procedure at the moment, but I think in a year's time, the cost may be half, it is reduced to half in a year's time. So this was a 69-year-old patient who had an anterior wall MI 7 years back, had PTCA stenting to LAD done 7 years back, but at that point his ejection fraction was only 30% moderate mitral regurgitation. Now for last 1 year, the patient had class 4 symptoms. So his symptomatology deteriorated, already had MI and LV dysfunction. So on screening, it was found out on echocardiogram that he had a critical aortic stenosis, moderate mitral regurgitation, and a very high PA pressure of 75, and ejection fraction dipped further to 20% only. On angiogram, which I'll show you, that LAD stent was patent, LCX was total occlusion, and RC was critical lesion at crux. So clearly he was not a surgical candidate, and he was denied surgery at 5 or 6 centers already. At that stage he came to me practically. So where he was denied surgery and he was heading towards a slow death, critical AS, 20% of ejection fraction, moderate MR, so no breakthrough. Practically. So at this point we discussed with the family that although even for TAVR is going to be high risk, and a TAVR procedure almost costs around 23 to 25 lakh rupees. So we are spending this much, but But still, there is 7-8% of risk involved because actually the ejection fraction of 20% and moderate MR and critical AS is not going to survive long. So family was quite cooperative. They gave a consent, told the family also that if at all something can take him out of this crisis, it would be TAVR. Otherwise, no surgeon would touch it because very high risk, already denied surgery from 5 centers. Now this is a T of this patient. It was a calcified bicuspid aortic valve. High morbid patient, the TAVR is indication. So it was bicuspid aortic valve. So challenging points in this case were LV dysfunction, ejection fraction of 20%, critical aortic stenosis with bicuspid aortic valve, moderate mitral regurgitation along with and very high PA pressures. So at this point, you know, we admitted the patient, decongested him because PA pressures were very high, decongested the patient for about 5-6 days and then planned this TAVR procedure of this patient. But prior to TAVR, this is the coronary and not me. So we decided that we will open at least one vessel to make the procedure even safer. So this is LAD which was stented 7 years back, but he had anterior MI. Circumflex was total occlusion and this is the right coronary artery which had a critical lesion here at the crux. So while we planned a TAVR in a hybrid OT or cath lab, which is OT cum cath lab, so I planned that we should first fix the right coronary artery with a stent, which we did as a first part. And this is the stent. So this is the stent being placed at the crux, opened well, and then in the same sitting I just went ahead to do the TAVR. This is how it is done. Through the aortic valve, a wire is crossed. A wire is crossed across the aortic valve, on which will advance the TAVR hardware. And as a first part, so this is the valve being prepared. As a first part, the ballooning of the aortic valve is done, the BAV, at a rapid pacing, and then this valve comes across the aortic valve and we slowly start deploying it. There are many technical aspects, I don't think I'll go into that detail, but this is how it is deployed. We start opening this valve slowly and see, now this is being opened here. Partially opened across the aortic valve. We come back, keep on opening the valve further, seeing various parameters, seeing the position of the valve as we open it, and then once we are sure that valve has opened up nicely, then we detach it, and once we detach it, then we can't retrieve it. So this is the valve opened, which crushes the native diseased valve, and there is a bioprosthetic valve inside this ring which starts functioning immediately. So this is the best part, that it crushes the valve which is diseased and a new valve is inside it which starts functioning immediately. So this is how the TAVR procedure is done. This was a specifically very complex and sick case, and the patient also responded well with this procedure. The PA pressures came down to 55, LV is improving, and the moderate MR is further reduced to mild. The third case, again a very interesting case. So this was a lady, 82-year-old lady, admitted at a hospital in Rewari with a history of chest pain, diagnosed there as inferior wall MI at Rewari. So next day the doctor at Rewari performed an angiography, and post angiography patient became unstable and had a pulmonary edema. Frank pulmonary edema, had to be intubated. The records showed this, and the family, I had done a procedure in the family prior also. The family came to me with the reports and mentioned that patient had to be ventilated post angiography, and the results show this, that ejection fraction was 45% with a mild MR and an inferior wall MI. They showed me the angiogram also. The angiogram showed the left system was totally non-critical and the right coronary artery was 99%. So something was not fitting in. I was not able to digest the whole scenario, but only inferior wall MI patient went into cardiogenic shock and pulmonary edema. second day post angiography, so something is missing somewhere. So family was very keen that they shift the patient to Medanta. They shifted the patient to Medanta. Once the patient reached Medanta, I was going through the record. There was some mention, and once we did the echocardiogram, we found out that the patient actually was having a post MI ventricular septal defect. So that was the reason of her instability and deterioration of the whole situation, and she went into cardiogenic shock because of inferior wall MI complicated by post MI VST. These are the patient subsets where they usually don't do well, and cardiogenic shock in these patients practically means that it's a high likelihood that we might lose these patients, and mortality is very high. So this was the picture, 82-year-old lady, inferior wall MI, post MI VST, intubated in shock. It was a very frail lady, almost 40-42 kgs. The third post MI day, once the patient shifted to us, this was the picture. The systolic blood pressure was 85 to 90 millimeter of mercury. The chest X-ray was frank pulmonary edema, and urine output was roughly a liter per day. So firstly, with the thing which was not done there, I just decided that let's go ahead with the intra-aortic balloon pump. The fourth post MI day, next day, patient was intubated, systolic BP of 95 on inotropes, urine output was same, around a liter, serum creatinine 1.8, now creatinine was showing high. Specifically in these patients it happens, even if there is no real oliguria happening, the creatinine keeps on going up because of the situation, the low cardiac output. The chest X-ray showed bilateral infiltrates, pulmonary edema picture. Fifth post-op day, 90 millimeter of mercury, systolic pressure on inotropes, chest X-ray further deteriorating, serum creatinine again going up, 2.1. Next day, situation going even a shade lower. 80 to 90 millimeter of mercury despite inotropes, chest X-ray deteriorating, urine output further falling, and serum creatinine going up. So we knew here she was not a surgical candidate, 40 kg lady, 82-year-old, everything deteriorating, and I knew clearly if we don't intervene here, we are going to lose this lady. So I talked to the family in detail that only way we can really salvage the lady is by closing that defect. If we don't close that defect, ventricle septal defect, she's not going to make it. Family understood. See, there are many factors nowadays. Nowadays we have been actually going through a tough situation. First, family should be convinced and updated about the whole picture. The risk of the procedure, the outcome of the procedure, the cost of the procedure, because if you don't do that, even if your intentions are very good, the 4 or 5 days later, if you lose that patient, family will come to you, say, you didn't explain, so how can we lose our patient? So I think it's worthwhile in the present scenario, be very communicative with the family. I think that's the main key point in treating the complex patients nowadays. So the echo showed the apical VST. I was telling you the discussion with the family. The family was quite cooperative. They understood everything. I gave them a picture that it's a 10% chance of mortality on table while we do this risky procedure. But then if she makes out, then she'll be better. The echo showed the apical VST. This is the transesophageal echo. See, here is the VST towards the apex. There is a defect with left to right shunting. The more complex point, there was no margin at the apex. So these are the kind of complex subsets where implanting a device is also very difficult. This is a 3D picture showing a rent in the septum, and this is how the procedure is done. Now, after having a good discussion with the family, we planned that we are going ahead with the procedure. So this is how it is done. This is a catheter in LV. LV angiogram is being done, and this is the VST. And once this is done, we take a wire across this defect from LV to RV, and then snare this wire into the jugular vein. So this loop is created. Now this is from the groin, femoral artery, aorta, then arch of aorta, this is LV, then the defect, RV, RA and into the jugular vein. Without this loop, we can't deliver the device. So this loop is must. Once this loop is created, then from the jugular access, we pass on a sheath from the RV into the LV and through which the device comes. Then the device is advanced. And then keep checking on transesophageal echo, it is the T probe, and on the fluoroscopy. So once a device is placed, one disc into the LV and another disc into the RV, and we are sure that we detach it, then we deploy this device after being sure of the things. And after this device, the LV angiogram is being done, and after a certain time, this closes the defect. So we were able to successfully do this procedure, although it was complex because there were no margins at the real apex to hold the device. But we were lucky in a way that device could be delivered and it was holding on and it sealed the defect. After this device was deployed, patient started showing signs of improvement. On the third day of the device, she was extubated, the blood pressure came up, the urine output improved, so all parameters improved on the third day. And now the right coronary artery occlusion was there, which resulted in inferior wall MI. It was quite a viable myocardium, only 45% of ejection fraction, not much of damage. So I thought once the patient was better extubated, let's open the right coronary artery. So this procedure I took after 4 days of the device. This was the right coronary artery here. 99%, and see this, while we are doing the right coronary artery, you can see the device also at the apical VST position sealing this. So this is the 3D picture of the device being deployed, and right coronary artery stenting after the device deployment. Patient is still fine, almost 10 months of follow up. She is 82 year old lady but very stout. She is a lady from Rewari, you know, guys who work in fields. So she still comes to my OPD and doing very well. As a general statistics, you know, 1-3% of post MI VST incidence without a reperfusion era, but in the reperfusion era the incidence has gone down. Usually it happens either within first 24 hours of MI or on third or fifth day. So post-MI VSR is a high mortality despite all advances. Though surgical correction is gold standard, many of these patients are too high risk. Closure is an alternative modality, especially in select patients with favorable margins. Large multiple defects best treated by surgery still. But practically what we require in these six subsets are a multidisciplinary team of cardiac surgeon, interventionist and a non-invasive cardiologist to look at the picture and evaluate these patients to give the best treatment strategy and best outcome to these patients. Thank you. So these were the three cases which revolve around the structural heart intervention, that led bronchus dilatations and stenting. I thought, you know, these are pretty unique to be discussed in these type of forums. So if at all any queries or any discussion points, please raise those issues so that we can generate a good discussion. Thank you.
1.752 lakh degrees. It is because of that strength, because of that valve. Now that valve is almost custom made. It comes in special sizes, but you know there is lot of expenditure which goes into the R&D of these situations. Actually the research had been going through many years. So the valve making and manufacturing itself is a very tedious process. The cost factor usually remains high. Once we pass on beyond a certain volume of interventions, then obviously we do expect that cost factor would come down.
Thank you. Dr. Gupta.
Sir, thank you for a very fascinating this presentation. would like to go back to the first case. The first case where you showed that the bronchial pinching has been there.
Because of the repeated surgeries, now child had two corrective surgeries. There was a fibrosis which was compressing externally, the fibrotic bands, which was compressing the bronchus externally. So this was found out to be the reason of the severe pinching of the bronchus.
So the thoracic surgeons had ruled out any kind of intervention in that?
Child had already undergone two surgeries and she was too sick to be intervened surgically again. So they had ruled out in this present situation, she was a septicemia, the white count was around 24,000. She was in big distress and she was even not maintaining saturation despite ventilator.
Okay. So post your intervention, sir, was there a kind of a plan which was set up that the problems that you mentioned could occur later in life? How to, you know, take off the stent or basically plan for some other kind of a corrective procedure? And I would like to invite Dr. Mangala's comment also for that.
These metallic self-expendable stents are meant for malignancy patients whose survival is, you know, 6 months, 1 year or whatever. But putting in a self-expended metallic stent in a child who's going to grow, I don't know how is he going to behave.
Before you raise a question, I myself pointed out that these are the tricky things associated with this. Now, we also found out that there are Chinese stents which are not metallic, which are, but they provide a scaffold. And they are retrievable stents, but unfortunately those were not available at that point of time in India, throughout India. We checked out Bombay, we checked out Chennai, we checked out Bangalore, everywhere. So we gave a gap of a day and find out this only, that is there a solution which is transient and then we take out the stent. But nothing was working out. So this was in desperation that we wanted to save child, and it actually showed a positive outcome. I don't have a follow-up of this patient, but you are right. It's not really advisable to put the metallic stents in a respiratory passage and leave it there, because they are going to alter the defense mechanisms. There is a, if you go into the literature, you will find these cases are more prone to have pneumonias, respiratory infections, because they are not clearing the secretions. So a retrievable stent, which is not non-metallic.
How did you do it? Did you use the flexible bronchoscope or you went through the rigid bronchoscope?
No, this was not. We just passed the wire through endotracheal tube and followed it fluoroscopically. There was no bronchoscope.
Ideally, this is done by a rigid bronchoscope and you can ventilate these patients.
We have done even a further one more case where we have done this bistanting silicone at the bifurcation of the trachea. That is not the metallic stent, but the silicone.
So, would you personally recommend this as a procedure of choice for such cases to follow in the future?
For the retrievable stents, yes. If we are stuck so much that we are not having any surgical options, and these things provide can be a real salvaging point in saving a patient, yes. So we, as he rightly mentioned, malignancy patients. So this is a high priority thing, that we relieve the symptoms.
So also you mentioned that the patient didn't come back for a follow-up. So, but what was the basic protocol that you advised the patient at the time of discharge, that what he should be doing?
No, absolutely. So we want that X-rays 3 monthly should be done and showed it to us. And if any symptoms of respiratory distress, we should be contacted.
No, but in the long term, like you said, that metallic stents should be causing some kind of a problem. So is there some kind of a corrective surgery or something that should be planned in the future, intervention?
No, it's very difficult for a corrective surgery inside a bronchus. But yes, if the issue is only that size is lagging behind, then we can further go with a bigger balloon and expand it further. It's not the lagging behind issue which is more concerning. The concerning issue is the defense mechanism, the pneumonias.
Yeah, sir, this is for the first time. We are seeing that our chairperson, Dr. Tulsi, is not the first to ask the question.
This is advantage.
He is not the first to ask.
We have got Dr. Tulsi here as the moderator.
My humble objection to the case shown, case number one, there was some obstruction on the left bunkers, but the trachea was on the right side. How?
No, it was not on the right side. It was almost.
Anyway, we can review.
We can review
all this. Secondly, sir, are we in a position to develop the reabsorbable stents? And we have in the cardiac stents. Reabsorbable.
No,
we don't have to take off.
No, not in this setting. Okay. So this setting is kind of diameters of 8 to 9, we are thinking. The abdominal stents came only for coronaries. That also is not really proving viable at the present moment because of various technicalities. So our solution here is, as already discussed, is a non-metallic stents and preferably retrievable stents.
In one of the questions, as you shown, post-MI-BSD, how common it is?
That's what I mentioned, I showed you incidence. Nowadays, with the reperfusion era, the incidence is 0.2-0.3%. But we do come across many patients where, now this subset is very tricky. Usually they don't do well. They are in shock, they are in pulmonary edema, and doing surgery is also not easy because what happens once a surgeon goes in, it's a friable myocardium. You know, it has to be after a certain days, almost 7 to 10 days post MI, when the myocardium is able to take the stitch. Wherever you take the stitch, it gives way. It is a friable myocardium. So these are tricky patients, and this is a alternative method to salvage these kind of patients by putting a plug hole in that BST. But even putting a plug hole is not easy. You know, so these are very sick subsets. So we are lucky here.
Real last question on that. What is bicuspid aortic valve in terms of TAVR?
Yes, so this is very important. So now normal aortic valve is tricuspid, there are three cusps. Bicuspid is congenitally, there are two cusps only. There are no third cusp, but there is small raphe. There is small raphe which is a remnant of that third cusp, you know, but it's not separating. So sometimes what happens, one, the opening is not centric in a bicuspid as it is in tricuspid. So because of that, there are some issues while deploying a TAVR. Third, if that raphe is calcified, you know, the raphe is calcified which will keep pointing. It can be a sharp thing, you know, and it may deform that TAVR while after it's deployed. So these are some of the points which are a potential problematic points by deploying a TAVR in bicuspid.
Rajneesh, let me tell you how delighted we are to have you and like to have you more
often. I don't know one.
My pleasure.
Now, just a small simple question. So, you are doing about 80 to 90 angioplasties per month. That is so nice. So, what angioplasties are you doing? Is it basically radial or humeral? Because today, I believe the gold standard is the radial angioplasty.
So almost we are doing both, 50-50%. Almost 40-45 plasties we are doing radial way and rest humeral way. The reason is, reason of doing still 50% humeral is that we are very time pressed. You know, and it's a teamwork. So I can't, my team associates, they prepare the case. Radial takes slightly longer time. You know, the time taken for the radial intervention may be slightly more as compared to femoral. Especially if the center is more tuned to do more femoral angioplasty. So at the moment I am doing 50% radial and 50% femoral.
So which is the safest?
See, it's practically a comfort zone of the operator. Both are safe. Now yes, as per data, the femoral interventions are associated with more vascular complications as compared to radial. But yes, radial, there are slightly more issues, as one I mentioned, the time. Second, sometimes hooking the left mains with radial, you know, there's more movement. So one should be really expert and comfortable while
tackling these points while doing regular interventions. Both are safe if in exploited.
Sir, structural heart disease, the topic of today, there's been a paradigm shift in the way you treat structural heart disease today. So more and more percutaneous catheter interventions?
Absolutely.
And more are coming?
Oh, there are more. So TAVR is a full reality. We are in
so not about TAVR.
I'm saying
structural heart disease.
Yes, yes. The TAVR is also a kind of we are changing the structure in the heart, changing the valve. We are also looking at a feasibility of a mitral valve repair and a mitral valve replacement, which has many challenges. If non-surgical interventions have many challenges, but that is being a lot of research is being really done into this direction, and I am hopeful in the next 5 years we will have an answer of even a percutaneous mitral valve.
Okay. So apart from the mitral valve repair and replacement, you mentioned TAVR. What about the LAA closure? This is the standard of care today in atrial fibrillation. So just a word on that.
Absolutely. This is absolutely right. LAA appendage closure has come up as a very good procedure. Now, indication-wise, LAA appendage closure indication is the patients who are having atrial fibrillation where there is some relative or complete contraindication for anticoagulation because of bleeding points or the health blood score is high. So those are the points where LAA appendage closure is indicated and it is being done, we are doing it.
Standard of care now. Okay, sir, talking about the LV aneurysm after MI, causing life-threatening tachyarrhythmias, that we also encountered with your percutaneous?
Absolutely. So even the LV aneurysm, there are a lot of modalities coming which will fix the LV aneurysm percutaneous.
So talking about the HOCM, surgical mastectomy is the gold standard, but today percutaneous transdermal myocardial ablation as well?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay. Sir, now before we end this, advanced imaging, like real-time 3D, transition visual echograph, cardiography, multi-spine CT and CMR is important for precise imaging. This is so important today. So is this now a sub-speciality of imaging?
It's absolutely true. I think the kind of interest and knowledge you guys have is tremendous. So firstly, before answering this, hats off to all you guys. Expected that this.
Sir, I warned you, this is the elite group of.
Absolutely. I started with this. So I think all compliments and my heart goes to all of you for still immersed in academics and being absolutely serious in academics. It's the real stuff. But this is where we are looking at. The minute CT will be added onto the cath labs. So DynaCT gives us a very good imaging while planning out lot of complex coronary interventions also like chronic total occlusions. Now just imagine a fact where we are planning our CTO opening, chronic total occlusion opening by a coronary intervention, and the DynaCT shows you the exact track which is superimposed over your picture and it keeps on showing you whether you are in a small twig or a branch or you are actually following into a true passage. You know, so just imagine how wonderful it would add on to and how it will going to impact the outcomes. It will be really marvelous. So it is happening actually.
Sir, a final word on the leadless pacemaker.
So this is
paradigm shift again.
This is also a reality.
Nice.
That Vedanta again is being done. Now again my job is to apprise you of the indication wise. It's done practically where because of certain reasons the access is not available or both subclavians are blocked, the access is gone, or a very old patient, 80-year-old, 85-year-old, just go and deploy a Micra, is the name of the leadless pacemaker, into the RV. It's a very simple procedure. But only thing is the slight limitation is that Micra is a single chamber pacemaker. So it's not as natural as a double chamber pacemaker which we do, but we are heading towards that. So firstly,
there is a lot of things being done on the double chamber also.
Thank you, sir. I don't have a question, sir. I am only going to compliment. Hello.
Can we have some decorum at the back, please?
Only going to compliment Dr. Kapoor for giving, you know, such rare cases. We have been attending so many cases. Today's cases were really very detailed.
Thank you, sir. My pleasure being here.
And we have Dr. Chauhan, sir. Where are you, Dr. Chauhan, sir?
Dr. Chauhan, sir.
First I would like to present you this certificate on behalf of Physician Forum of India. And I would like a very senior member who completed his MBBS before I was born to give the certificate to sir, to Dr. Rajesh Kapoor.
But he looks younger than you.
Yeah, on behalf of Physician Forum of India.